Snapshot 23W31A updates Minecraft to Data Pack version 16 with lots of news for commands and functions, changes to display entity interpolation, and more. My name is Sliced Lime, and I'm here to guide you through these changes. Let's start with the pack format itself. Both resource and data packs now support multi-version packs. This allows you to create packs that are compatible with multiple versions of the game, starting with this one. This is done by including a supported formats field, which lists all supported pack versions. Packs can also contain overlay directories, which are sub-pack folder structures that are applied on top of the base packs, but only for certain version ranges. That means you can have a shared base for all supported versions of the pack, but separate files where needed. An overlay can replace or add files, but not remove files from the base pack. These overlays are added in a new overlay section in the pack metadata. Let's talk about command news and changes to functions. You can now continue long commands on separate lines by ending a line with a backslash. The following line is then appended with its leading and trailing whitespace trimmed. There's also support for function macros. Any line beginning with a dollar sign marks it as a macro line, and a function becomes a function macro if it contains any macro lines. Each macro line also contains one or more substitution placeholders in the form of a dollar sign and then a variable name in parentheses. To call a function macro, it needs to get substitution values for all the variables in the function macro. This is done using a new form of the function command, sending parameters in data form to the function macro. The simplest form of this command is to include all the data in literal form in a compound, like is shown in these examples. You can also use a more dynamic form, function with, and a data source. This is specified exactly like you'd specify a data source for the data get command. Either way, the resulting data must be a compound, and it must contain entries for all the variables in the function macro. There can also be more data in that compound, it is completely ignored if that is the case. What happens when a function macro is called is that the values provided are substituted in place of the variable specifications and the resulting commands are executed as a function. If the result contains any syntax errors, the whole call fails and the entire function call is skipped. Now, some things to note about macros. Keep in mind that they are not function calls with arguments in that substitution happens on a source level. This means any non-string types are converted to string form before substitution, and it also means any macro lines in the function need to be re-evaluated, which comes with a performance cost. In terms of the performance of macros, any regular commands in the function are still pre-parsed like for regular functions. Only the commands that have any substitutions will be re-parsed. The game will also attempt to cache the active parameter set used for the last few calls, which means if you repeatedly call a function macro with the same data, it is likely to be more efficient. That isn't all for commands though. There are several new commands in this version as well. Let's start with the random command. Random lets you draw random values and control the random generation of random sequences. There are two subcommands for drawing random values, random value and random roll. Both take a range as a parameter and both do the same thing, randomize a value within that range. The difference is that random roll also announces the result in chat so that everyone can see it. These forms are usable by anyone, you do not need to have operator permissions. An advanced version that you do need operator permissions to use is to add a random sequence ID to the end of the command. This draws a random value out of that specific sequence, producing a deterministic and seed-based value by default. There's one more subcommand which is used to control random sequence generation. It is random reset. Random reset is followed either by an asterisk for everything or a sequence ID to reset. This resets the sequence in question or all the sequences if you specified that. In addition, you can also control the random sequence seed by adding a seed number and specifying whether the world seed and the sequence ID should be included in the resulting seed. By default, these parameters are 0, true, and true. Setting the include world seed parameter to false means the random sequence will have the same result regardless of which world it is being used in. Setting the include sequence ID value to false means that you'll get the same sequence regardless of the sequence ID, which can be used to set up multiple parallel sequences, for instance. Using an asterisk to reset all the sequences also sets the default parameters, which are then used for any newly created sequences. Let's move on to our next new command, execute if function. This is a new conditional for calling functions and proceeding if the result is a success. The syntax is execute if or unless function, followed by the ID of a function or function tag. Then the continuation of the execute command. The function or function tag is run and the execute command continues if or unless at least one of the functions succeeded. A function success is defined as the function using the return command to return a value, and that value being non-zero. Speaking of the return command, that has also been extended with a new form, return run. This form of return executes a specified command and uses the result value of that command as a return value for the function. If that command fails, the return value is instead zero. With those fairly massive news out of the way, let's quickly walk through some other small changes and fixes. The below name display slot selector in the scoreboard command is now below underscore name, written in all lowercase. And two fixes have been made to the item command, which can now remove items within chiseled bookshelves and replace items in jukeboxes. In game rule news, the random tick speed game rule now also affects the accumulation of snow and the conversion of water to ice. Some attribute news. Max absorption is now an attribute called generic.max_absorption. It acts similarly to the max health attribute, but controls the max amount of absorption hearts. When setting the absorption amount in an entity's data, the max absorption serves as the upper bound. In entity news, the passenger offsets have been adjusted for most mobs, so summoned passengers and the ride command should now produce less glitchy results. You can also see the attachment point of riders when using the F3 plus B hitbox debug mode. A number of AI fixes have also been made for AI that would break in several different ways when riding or being ridden by certain combinations of other entity types. In game event news, the entity roar and entity shake events have been removed and replaced with an entity action event, which is also used for some other entity actions. In tag news, a new damage type tag called no knockback has been added, which causes knockback to not be caused by that damage. Vanilla types added to this tag include damage from events like explosions, where the event itself also causes knockback separately. A new entity type tag called non-controlling rider has been added for entities that don't take over control of a vehicle when riding it. And there are two new block tags, concrete powder for all the concrete powder blocks, and camel sand step sound blocks for all the blocks that camels make the special sand step sound on. Let's wrap up with changes to display entity interpolation. Display entities now start updating their client-side position and rotation on the first tick after an update. In previous versions, updates were applied in the same tick as the update was received, which could cause uneven motion. This new behavior is similar to how armor stands, mobs, and players interpolate. There's a new field as well called teleport duration, which controls this behavior and which is a value in ticks. If it is set to zero, it means that updates are applied immediately. And one means that the display entities will move from their current position and rotation to the updated ones over the course of a tick. Higher values spread the movement over multiple ticks. Note here that these changes apply to the position and rotation of the entity itself, not its internal display transformation. The teleport duration value takes effect whenever the position or rotation changes, so changes to the value only applies to position and rotation changes made after it changed. Final note here is that when writing another entity, things work exactly as before. And that's it for Data Pack version 16. Thank you for watching, I hope this has been useful. My name is SliceLime, and I'll see you next time.